Right now, we have lots of public spaces on the internet in the sense that we get together on Twitter or on Facebook and we talk about social and political issues. But these aren't spaces that have been designed for those purposes. Instead, they've been designed as spaces to capture information about us, to market to us. And many people are starting to observe that these spaces may not actually be very good for our civic life. If we are not, in fact, paying for the services that we have, we are not customers, we're actually the product being sold. And these networks obviously work very, very hard to squeeze information and data out of us and present us to advertisers and to the markets. I have no interest in putting Facebook or YouTube out of business. But I do think that we need to take a close look at where those tools are falling short. They are falling short in helping us encounter a diverse range of views. They are falling short in helping us get beyond the shouting match between the left and right and actually getting into constructive political discussions. And it's my belief that if we consciously decided to design digital media spaces to complement the ones that we have out there supported by the market, we would end up with a more robust public sphere. If we could get people interacting more with their neighbors, interacting more with small groups of people, I think we might be able to break out of some of these federal levels of politics. And so the systems that I'm designing are not designed for 3 billion users as Facebook is designed for. I am trying to build hundreds of thousands of social media spaces designed to serve anywhere from 30 to 3,000 people. The key is not just that you build a small thing, it's that you build a lot of small things. So let me tell you two of the small things that I'm building right now. We are in the early stages of building social networks with a newspaper chain in the mountain west of the US. These are weekly newspapers for communities of generally fewer than 5,000 people. And what this newspaper chain had a vision for, well before we started talking to them, was a community discussion that was attached to the weekly newspaper. So this would be a community space for discussion online, and it would be moderated and sort of co-hosted by the reporters and by the editors of the paper. And we've been looking at this and saying, you know what, we can help you build out the infrastructure to do that. So we've been customizing a piece of open source software called Mastodon. We've been building community governance tools into it. We've been building moderation tools into it. So some of the first people who are going to be using the system that we're designing are people in small towns in Arizona and Nevada. So we're not exactly going for the political elites in our first round. The second round of tools that we want to do, and here we're still trying to figure out who's going to bite first, is around town meetings in Western Massachusetts. So out here in Western Mass, most of our towns are small enough that they're governed via town meeting rather than by a city government. What that means is that once a year, we sit down, usually in a high school gymnasium, although these days in COVID days, it's often outside in a field. And we go line by line through the town budget, often for 6 or 8 hours. We could do better. We would probably do a much better job if we could start that conversation online, ask the sort of clarifying questions, come to the issues that we actually differ on, use the meeting to make progress on those issues, and then continue afterwards. No one in their right mind wants to do that on Facebook. No one wants to do it in an environment that can be that toxic, where it's very hard to filter people out because they're not members of town. But that's exactly what a local social network can do for you. So the goal is not to grab the university professors or the legislators, right? Those folk already have good places to have conversations. To build these sorts of online communities, you build around a common interest, a common need, and that need for self-government. And the idea is that you also don't try to replace everything else that's out there. When you're joining one of these social networks, we don't ask you to stop using Facebook, we don't ask you to stop using Twitter, we ask you to try this as well. And in fact, we're building tools that make it possible for you to have increased control of all those social networks in the same place, so that you can actually have control over your Facebook or Twitter feed that those companies don't give you, and the ability to bring in these new types of social networks that we're building as well. Part of what we've been finding so interesting about this, when we've been talking to this Western newspaper chain, they had assumed that building their own social network was a six-figure problem. And we came to them and said, we think you can do this for $40 a month. It might be 60, but we think it's pretty easily under $1,000 a year. Almost all the work is on the software development. And the software development probably does require, over time, six figures, seven figures worth of work. But actually running a community of just a few thousand people, particularly if you're not trying to support it through ads, that's probably under $100 a month. These things just aren't that difficult to run. What's expensive is keeping it healthy. What's expensive is the work that you do moderating it, the work that you do around governance. But remember, the whole point of this is to flex the civic muscles. We want people to have that work, because that's how we get stronger as neighbors and as civic actors. It's certainly possible that people will find ways to host communities and make money about this. But I'm committed to ensuring that the code that's coming out of UMass is open source, and that anyone who wants can build their own version of it at any time. I actually think something we should be doing right now is taxing surveillance advertising and using some of the funds from that to subsidize research into this space. I think much in the same way that the Corporation for Public Broadcasting took taxpayer money and used it to figure out, hey, we might need something for five-year-olds, and let's fund Sesame Street. I actually think that's not a bad model. I would also point out that surveillance advertising increasingly is looking like a dangerously unregulated field, where there are thousands of information brokers sort of passing information back and forth. It's also looking hyper-concentrated, where Google and Facebook have an enormous amount of control over it. So that's how I think in the long run we fund research in the space. In the short run, my research is going to be funded by the Progressive Foundation community. So we're already in advanced talks with two nationwide foundations in the U.S. who have expressed a strong interest in supporting this work. In the long run, how do you support these things? With the newspaper that we're talking with, this becomes part of your newspaper subscription. It's part of what gets you to subscribe. The digital public sphere, the spaces that we have conversations online, is too important to be left up to the market. We need to find ways to imagine and build online spaces that are good for us as neighbors and citizens.